How many newsletters have ghostwriters? There's a lot that comes into an acquisition that I think a lot of people don't understand.
You've built a business that's doing 3 million ARR in 18 months. There's dozens of companies that would purchase you for like $50 million.
And people were raising absurd rounds. Like people were raising like $5 on $25 million seed rounds.
That's part of the reason I hated VC too. The fact that you were able to convince some VC who's not even an expert in your space that you're worth X amount of dollars doesn't mean anything.
Now you have to achieve bigger things. You have to show more.
We're going for 600 million to a billion plus exit right now.
Your life will probably be marginally different with a few tens of millions of dollars versus hundreds of millions of dollars.
We've been offered to get acquired for that amount and without hesitation said no, like we're on the bigger things. You realize how many people trust you and go out of their way on this like entrepreneurship startup journey. And like, I can never fuck them over.
Cheers.
How are we?
Welcome to the podcast.
Glad to be here.
It's called Risky Business. What do you think of that name?
I like it.
You like it?
Cool. Yeah. Original. Haven't heard another podcast with that name, so sure.
I love it. Well, I appreciate you being on the pod and coming to share your story. I told you this before we started, but I've listened to you on a couple of podcasts, and I feel like everybody fixates on your background at Morning Brew and some of the more intricate details of Beehiiv, but I wanted to like touch on that really quickly and then never talk about it again.
Down.
So give the quick spiel to the viewers on your background, starting at Morning Brew, being the second employee, and then how that got you to transition into what Beehiiv is today.
Depending on how sure you want to be, I think you just did it. But yeah, so I joined Morning Brew back in 2017 as the second employee. So the only engineer, did product, did growth, came in, built the referral program, built the website. Was too naive not to use like a third-party platform. So we built our own content management system, built our own ad management platform for the sales and copywriting team. So Morning Brew at the end of the day was this totally bespoke ecosystem. For those who don't know, it's a daily email newsletter. It goes out now Monday through Sunday, was Monday through Friday. They got acquired by Business Insider in 2020, coincidentally, like 2 to 3 weeks after I left, which is interesting timing. But yeah, rode that wave. It was amazing and learned a lot there.
Nice. And then when did you get the idea for Beehiiv and what is Beehiiv?
Yeah, so working backwards, Beehiiv is an email newsletter platform that helps creators and publishers create, monetize, and scale their audience. The idea probably came just from while working at Morning Brew, we would get tons of feedback from readers. It's very easy to respond via an email. Readers were always asking, what referral program do you use? What data do you look at? How are you growing so quickly? Why does the newsletter look the way it does? And like, I knew the answer to all those questions because I built a lot of that. And so there was like a huge appetite from people who either had hobbyist newsletters or were working at a different media publication to see what we were doing well. And like, fortunately at Morning Brew, things were like going very well. And my job and the engineers on the team, we were building internal tech tools for our team. So we had a content team of 10 writers. We had a sales team of 15, 20 people. Super fun to build for people you know and you sit besides. I feel like a lot of engineers and product people want to build for thousands and thousands of people or millions of people, really. And so the impetus really came from there was a need for what we were building in the market, which we validated from the inbound request. And other companies in the space were raising a lot of money, getting a lot of attention. It was clear that newsletters were establishing themselves as like a, not a new medium, it's anything but new, but like a medium that a lot of people were turning to own their audience and monetize and build a business. So it's an idea that me and my now co-founders, but employees back at Morning Brew would always talk about.
Very interesting. And when I think email newsletter publisher, like my mind goes to like the Morning Brews, the Axios, the, and then, but there's also like, you know, solopreneur newsletter as well. On Beehiiv today, how many are like solopreneur newsletter run by like one person or a small team? And how many look like big scale company like Future Party or some of the other ones that have like big brand names?
Yeah. So we have like Future Party, Boston Globe, like definitely like a where we're focusing. I mean, to answer your question more directly, I'd probably say 80-20 of like solopreneur, and I'd even toss in like 2 to 3 person teams and like the solo smaller operation. Versus 20% larger organizations like a Boston Globe, like Future Party. We have like newsletters in Canada that operate in like 15 different cities and have a newsletter for each city. So that's where we want to go. I think the goal was coming from our experience of what we built at Morning Brew, let's build for the next wave of Morning Brews. And the good thing about that is the features and what people want actually overlap pretty one-to-one. So if, even if I'm just a hobbyist writing about politics by myself, odds are I want the same functionality that Morning Brew has. So I want the referral program. I want the design templates. I want the data. I want the website. Mm-hmm. And so building for the power users is like who we're building for, knowing that the long tail of solopreneurs want to tap into those same tools and capabilities.
Yeah, it's interesting because my background at Shopify, Shopify seems to have wanted to do the same thing for e-commerce entrepreneurs, where it's like, hey, everybody wants an e-commerce store that gives them, you know, 80% of the functionality that these big box retailers have on their .coms. And it almost seems like you're trying to do the same playbook, but for newsletter, where it's like, why shouldn't this solo email newsletter team or this small group of 2 to 3 people be able to have the same level of functionality in a referral system or all these other things that a Morning Brew has and be able to compete on the same thing? It's like now you're democratizing that access and
yeah,
the functionality.
Democratizing is like the classic like phrase that people use and probably overuse. But I mean, even when we were at Morning Brew, when we were looking at all the different, they called ESP, email service providers, like the legacy incumbent players in the space, we looked at Axios, we looked at the Skim as like two companies that were doing something that we looked up to. So like the Skim had like the Skim Ambassadors referral program way before Morning Brew. And like that was kind of our inspiration. Mm. Axios, very legitimate organization, putting out great newsletters and scaling that vertically and horizontally as well. And so they were much bigger, better funded. And as like a small scrappy startup, you kind of look up to who is doing something similar in your space that might be a little bit ahead of you. So when we were evaluating what email platforms that we wanted to use, we just looked at them. They were using the same tool. And we're like, oh, if they can do everything they're doing on that tool, so can we. So we kind of blindly follow them. And that's kind of like the approach of like follow the leader. Now everyone looks at Morning Brew as where are they building their tech? What platforms are they using? And people kind of blindly follow the leader of whoever in that space is doing well or that they look up to. And so that's kind of what we've approached our growth and go-to-market strategy with. Let's attract and build for the power users. Let's get them on board.
Yeah.
And knowing that everyone recognizes, let's say, the Future Party or Boston Globe's a big brand, yeah, or the Milk Road, people kind of blindly see like, okay, they're growing. Their newsletter looks great. They have cool features and functionality. All my friends are reading it. They're doing something right. Now that I'm getting into the newsletter space, let's just use what they use. And so that is, I think, the power of going after like the power users and the big heavy hitters.
Yeah.
If you can win them over, the long tail, people kind of just follow in step with whatever the larger players are doing.
Makes sense. How many newsletters have ghostwriters?
It's a great question. I obviously don't know the answer to that. But my guess is, well, what I think is really interesting, I'd love to get your take on,
yeah,
is we have gone to market to date with, there's already people and companies that have newsletters. They're using XYZ tool. I think we do it better. Let's show them why we're better. Let's move them over to our platform. Fairly standard playbook of growing a company, identifying vulnerabilities with competitors in the marketplace and providing better solutions. I think the next wave of what we want to do is there's so many people on TikTok, Instagram, YouTube that are amazing at curating an audience. They have incredible ideas. They're great at creating content.
Yep.
Email isn't part of their toolkit yet, but they're like leaving money on the table for not just repurposing their content in email. And the benefit, like if you are creating 2 YouTube videos a week, how come you can't repurpose that and like maybe write an article or 2 tangential to what you just created content on? And it's kind of like symbiotic where you have the newsletter pushing back to your YouTube channel. At the end of every YouTube video, have people subscribe to your newsletter, yep, knowing that they're not going to always see both. And so taking non-newsletter people and content creators and turning them into someone who would want to create content in a newsletter is like a new growth strategy that we're starting to pursue. And the reason I bring this up now is to your point about ghostwriting. What we've seen in experimenting with this is a lot of people are like, I'm great at TikTok because I can create a funny 30-second clip. I'm lazy and I don't feel like writing a newsletter. And so that's like the introduction of there are teams and people that will ghostwrite and like get sign off from the content creator on TikTok to build their newsletter arm. And I see that as like a huge opportunity. And I think it's just money left on the table where you have like an amazing large audience on TikTok. And also if you've seen like the whole like TikTok Montana thing, who knows how that stands, but like that's like not your audience forever and it can go quicker than you think. Same thing we were talking about earlier. Emails are a lot more reliable and like a direct relationship that's portable.
Yep.
So that is a new preview of like kind of where I see like another channel for growth being is converting people who don't have a newsletter into having a newsletter as one of their many offerings. And with that, I'd say, like, I think there will be more ghostwriters because a lot of these YouTubers probably don't want to write a newsletter.
Yeah.
But if they can get someone with the creative direction that they align with write for them and they sign off on it, there's, like, a lot of money to be made.
How do people find... Is that something where, like, people go to Craigslist or, like, Upwork and they're, like, writer and then they just, like, try to build that relationship? I mean, assume there's also agencies. Like, what are the options that someone has to do that? And I'm assuming there's, like, an AI play here, too, where now... You can take the transcript from YouTube video,
feed it to AI, and have it put out a newsletter. But I think people, like, but then you have to think, is that, like, an action, is that something that's, like, sign up to as a newsletter? It's just, like,
probably
transcribed,
not.
Like, because you have to actually add, like, the thing, like, Colin Samir did an amazing job with the published press. They have their YouTube channel, they have a podcast, and then they touch on, like, tangential stories in the newsletter in written format.
Totally.
That they all kind of play well, really, like, together, they're great. But they're not just, like, taking the exact YouTube video and transcribing that and putting that into text form in a newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's more strategy involved with that.
Totally.
I think they're, like, a textbook, like, a example of what other content creators should be doing.
The interesting thing about Colin and Samir, and I agree, they're, like, the gold standard example in creators that have been able to build a successful newsletter brand is they've hired writers. And they give credit to those writers. And they actually act more as the, like, curator and the stamp of approval that these stories and these takes are something that we stand by. But this is like Nathan writing about this story and he's the one who's done the interview and has this insight in his own perspective, which I think is cool. That seems to be more
I
like
think that is the model. And like to your point, like where do you find, like, I wouldn't go to Craigslist.
Yeah.
But they already have, they're like broadcasting videos to millions of people. They could probably say like the same way that the My First Million pod guys like find producers or whatever. They just talk about it on the podcast. They already have a brand that people already listen to them. They're getting tens of thousands of downloads. Odds are that there's someone that's hungry, hustling, wants an additional opportunity to write a newsletter. They should just ask directly, like, hey, I'm just thinking about building a newsletter. Who wants to write it? Well, I guess they get thousands of qualified candidates.
If I'm a YouTuber and I'm going to start a podcast or I'm looking to or thinking about it, I'm curious if you could rank these things in order of what you think, in order of importance for the success of my newsletter. The design of the newsletter, the substance of the like information within the newsletter, the writing style itself, and last but not least, the frequency in which I send that newsletter.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, you kind of hit on like all the most important things of the newsletter. So like-
If you were to rank those.
Yeah. Well, I mean, substance first, right? Yeah. Like at the end of the day, if someone's going to take the time to open your email or look forward to it, like, I mean, there's emails I genuinely look forward to reading to hear the take of someone's thoughts about the Apple headset or whatever it is that I want to read about. So like substance is always like content is king. So like substance needs to be great. Frequency, and frequency doesn't mean like daily or weekly, but like consistency. Like you at the end of the day, you want to build a habit. Like I know my favorite podcasts when they're dropping and when I'm behind on episodes and when I need to get caught up. Same with newsletters.
Is there a cadence that you think works? Like on YouTube, a lot of people say weekly uploads is like what you should be hitting, especially when you're trying to get something off the ground. Obviously there's like a daily vlogging thing that is really great for kickstarting something. What's that ideal cadence look like on newsletters?
Probably like the classic, it depends. Like what are you covering, right? Like if you're covering something like AI right now, there's enough news and fundraising and everything else that you could do it daily. Granted, daily is a lot of work. People don't understand how much time goes into writing. Like I write our product updates and it takes me between 3 and 4 hours whenever I do that. It's probably weekly, bi-weekly, but it's a lot of work. So what I would not do is say we're launching a daily thing without knowing the work. Like work your way up to that. And if there's enough content and people are engaging with it, daily is great because it's more impressions per week and that's more monetization opportunities, more touch points with your audience. Weekly sounds great. I think anything less than weekly, it's hard to build an established expectation with your audience. But I think weekly is like a great starting point for most people. Then go twice a week. So that's like the second, I know you said design and what was the other one? Like writing style,
like the voice that it almost got. That's what I think like using AI tools kind of always misses a little bit, which is like, can you get this to sound the way that it reads really well? I think sometimes like ChatGPT just throws stuff in this, like, unless you tell it like write like this. And sometimes it just doesn't have the voice that I think you want to get unless you're like a prompt master and you can capture that really well.
Yeah. Prompt master. Yeah, I don't know. So voice is interesting because voice doesn't really jump out at me in most newsletters that I read. It's like very informative. The Morning Brew is the example, right? Or like the exception there where like they are sarcastic, Seinfeld-esque, like humor. And they were able to build, I think, a brand affinity. And so much success comes from the fact that it's traditionally boring business news, but told by someone that feels like your best friend, that adds jokes and like very culturally relevant.
Yep.
Outside of like Morning Brew and like Milk Road does a good job. It's like memes are like kind of like a cheat code.
The Hustle's another one.
The Hustle is good. They have a good voice as well. So yeah, I mean, there's a way to differentiate based on voice. I think that becomes easier if you're already a content creator who has a voice and can lean into that. And that's where like maybe you could probably feel out ghostwriters from like a little bit of disingenuity. I'm not going to be able to say that word. We'll cut that. Where like you know the voice and the way that a certain content creator communicates.
Mm-hmm.
And when they completely miss in the newsletter form, like it's probably a ghostwriter.
Yeah.
But yeah, voice, it depends what, I mean, again, everything's it depends from, are you going for entertainment? Because this person's super entertaining, interesting, and you want to learn from them?
Yeah.
Or is it, I'm just interested in AI for work purposes or as an interest, and I just want information. I want to know, I don't have the time to scour the internet of what is being released, what companies are raising funding, what new capabilities exist in AI. So I go to a content curator that feeds me that daily. And like for that, I feel like voice is probably less important. It's just informative.
It's like a lot of people, I think the acquired skill that they've had in another part in their career. So if they're like really good at business or really good at another potential skill, they've spent years crafting that, mastering it, building this knowledge. And then newsletter becomes this place where you can just start actually just taking that and writing a little bit and putting in this like very minimal effort to put that out there and have really large returns versus like you see the same people trying to do that in YouTube and they're spending enormous sums of money where like, you know, you see the Alex Hormozis of the world enter into creating content and, you know, he's invested a ton of money and I think it's a loss leader for him in building public awareness and impression so that he can build more notoriety for acquisition.com. And I think like it just goes to show that newsletter is a very cost-effective way of essentially running the same playbook where you take something where you've spent years and years developing like a cornered resource of knowledge and then now all of a sudden that becomes your medium of sharing it. And really the only thing you have is the time in which you have to go put that in and the effort and skill you actually take into making it entertaining and consistent enough for people to check in.
Yeah, I mean, super low cost, super low effort to get started. And it also scales like better than anything you could imagine in the sense of whether you're writing to 10 people or 10 million people, the amount of effort to actually write the newsletter and distribute it is more or less the same. The cost slightly changes when you're sending to that many people. But outside of that, which is a fairly flat cost, like at Morning Brew, I'd say two co-founders, Alex and Austin. Alex was doing sales, Austin operations. Neil was writing the newsletter. I was doing the product and engineering, and Jenny was growing it. Five-person team at one point. We could have ran that business as a five-person team, whether we were sending to 100,000 people or to 500,000, 5 million people, whatever, and just stayed as a lifestyle business indefinitely. It was a lot of work and we were definitely getting burnt out. But like there was a point where we like looked around and like they wanted to go more venture-backed or like venture-type return, which obviously worked out for them. But like we looked around and like we're making $5 million this year. It's a 5-6-person team. Like if you could sell ads, write the newsletter and grow and the tech works and like things like Beehiiv make it easier. So like me in that situation is no longer needed. Like it's a very economical and scalable business.
One thing that I feel like you and I have related on for a while has been just like the entry into entrepreneurship and also entry into like being a venture-backed company or venture-backed entrepreneur. It seems like a lot of people, and I think we chatted about this really early when we met, was like people get into running a venture-backed company and it becomes about chasing rounds. And I think we both bonded on the fact that it was like, oh my God, how do we avoid that? How do we like not lose perspective on the fact that at the end of the day, what we got to do is build a really good company and we can't get into this thing of like, oh, what metrics do I need to show for my next round? Or how do I make investors happy? I've admired you as an entrepreneur because I think you've always stayed very like level-headed on what do I need to do to make this business great, regardless of what external validation says about where I should get it. How have you done that? And what advice do you have for other entrepreneurs that are in the place of like considering venture, thinking about raising money? Like, how have you done that? And what kind of things should entrepreneurs be focusing on? How should entrepreneurs think about raising venture?
Yeah. So loaded question, a lot to get to.
Yeah.
I'd say foundationally, and like every business is different. Some are very capital intensive and you need money to get off the ground and launch and accelerate. Or you are a late entrant into a market and like you really need capital to be able to reach the market share that you need. I've always been not anti-VC because then that will make me a huge hypocrite for everything else I'm about to say. But I've been around a lot of entrepreneurs and startups where the conversation is, are you hitting your metrics to raise your Series A or your Series B? And it almost seems like they're like it's a performance to impress their next future investors rather than how do you serve your customers better and how do you build like a sustainable, profitable business? Because if you do those, the investors will come easy. And so our full history of raising money and just like getting the company off the ground, we raised, now I'm blanking on all the money. We raised 2.6 initially, as like a pre-seed seed, just because one, younger in my career, like I didn't have a ton of money to sit on, couldn't go all in and not pay ourselves. So we also had like upfront like contracts with like our email vendor, our website hosting database. So like there were some upfront costs where we were in our career. And like the hiring that we wanted to do, get it off the ground, we just needed some outside capital. So we raised a 2.6 million seed round. That was great. My goal was to never raise money again. I was like, 2.6 feels like a lot of money.
You also raised 2.6 at a time where people were raising absurd rounds.
This was summer 2021. Yeah.
Yeah. Like people were raising like $25 million seed rounds.
Pre-product, pre-users. So like, yeah, we went in summer 2021 saying, here's my hypothesis, here's the background, here's my co-founders. We all did this at Morning Brew. We hinted at what we were going to build and have a wait list of 500 people. So there's like some sort of light validation there. Here's the roadmap. We just need a little money to pay our vendors, to hire ourselves, to hire an additional 5-6 people, get this off the ground.
I'd say congrats, but I also think that raising also, like I think a lot of people are like, great, you raised so much money. But what I will say is actually, I think now it's actually more pressure on you, right? Now you have to achieve bigger things. You have to show more. And so I think like now is like, that's actually more of what it is. I think now you have more ammo to reach higher. So this is actually not the congratulatory moment. It'll be in, you know, a few years when you get to either the next round or to your next large milestone. But how do you think your life, your job and your day-to-day as an entrepreneur is going to change over the next 12 months as you start to really put this thing in hyperdrive?
I'd say just to double click on what you just said, it's like really interesting and something I never really thought about until recently. I talked to Austin Reef, the CEO of Morgan, like he's a good friend. And he would always say like, he would always warn me against raising money because he's like, right now, optionality is key for you. Like you, Tyler Denk, as an individual, you've built a business that's doing 3 million ARR in 18 months. There's dozens of companies that would purchase you for like $50 million and you could walk away from this like $10, $15 million in the next year.
Yeah.
And so that optionality is great, like as an individual. The second that we sign and take venture capital at a $65 million valuation, those companies can't buy us for 50 mil. And so we've just wiped out a whole tier of companies that would have maybe considered buying us for 50, 60, 70 mil.
Yeah.
They are no longer in the running to ever purchase us. And so now we've just elevated companies. The amount of companies that can acquire us in a successful exit
is really low now.
Increased now considerably.
Yeah.
And the goal of like, if you were to ask me 2 years ago, if we could get acquired in 18 months, would I take $50 million? I'd say, you mean I work for 18 months and there's a $50 million exit? 10 out of 10 times I'm taking that. And we've been offered to get acquired for that amount and without hesitation said no, like we're on the bigger things.
Wow.
And so that is a very interesting way of thinking about things. Like once you accept that venture capital to $65 million valuation, we're going for $600 million to a billion plus exit right now. And like that optionality that once was like very fruitful and available to me is no longer there. So to your point of like the added pressure, like it did nothing but eliminate a bunch of potentially not easier, but attainable shorter term exit opportunities in hopes of a much larger one at a future date. But
How did you make that decision given that your life will probably be marginally different with a few tens of millions of dollars versus hundreds of millions of dollars? Why do this and why say, I'm going to say no to this big check that will also give me the freedom and the lifestyle and the comfort that, you know, many people never get to have in their lives for this now high risk, high reward?
Could be nothing.
Could be nothing.
Could be nothing.
Could be nothing. You could have had this like Malibu beach house and you would have been fun and your kids would have went to the best school and you would have had a lot of time to spend with your friends and your family. But instead, you're choosing this grind of you're still going to be up at 11:30, maybe not answering customer service emails, but putting out other fires or planning stuff and building decks or whatever, all for this like looming larger payout. And also, you know, if the next time, if you ever do raise another round, that pressure.
Then everyone who would have acquired us at maybe 400 or 500 mil no longer is there.
And that's like, now it's like, whatever, 10 companies in the world that even have the ability to do that and half of it's in stock, et cetera. How'd you make that decision? How do you think about that now?
Because like, I'm also very realistic in saying like, I love the grind. Well, that's really why. Like, I love doing this.
Yeah.
I'm 29. I have so much energy. I'm so fired up. I actually see the opportunity of what we're building. Like, if we are just starting to accelerate now and we've had this success with very little money in the bank, we've had the worst product we've ever had. It gets only getting better. We've been understaffed from day one and still hiring up. And like, we're now creating new monetizable assets and opportunities that like didn't exist before. So like, going back to like, email service providers used to be a cost. Now we're a platform that's additive to the entire ecosystem. Like, I see a multi-billion dollar exit for sure. And like, that's what I'm chasing. And so once you see that, it becomes a lot easier to turn that down. I'd also say the flip side of that is like, I'm very realistic and everything in life is an opportunity cost, right? So I am stressed beyond belief waking up at 5:30 every morning and working till 11 o'clock at night. And like, what does it to me as like an individual mean to have like economic security, which I've never really had, to help my parents retire, to like, you know, like the opportunity cost of not being stressed for the next 3, 4, 5 years of my life is like very real. And what's the cost of that, of having 15 mil tomorrow versus chasing 150 million that's not even guaranteed, but it's going to cost you 4 years of stress and anxiety and hustle and everything else that comes with it. And like, that's a very real trade-off and very difficult thing. But I think that's true of everyone who turns down a potential acquisition. You're always chasing more, and you can look back in 10 years and be an idiot and walk away with nothing, which I've already accepted as like a very real possibility.
But it's when you love to play the game, then it just becomes, it's like, oh, I love doing this anyway. So even if I sold, what I'd still probably go throw myself into another project and work really hard.
Also, when the competitors are the ones that make the acquisition, like, they only want that acquisition because we're eating their market share, right? And so like, I smell blood, and like, that's where I want to be a market leader. The other thing too, I think, like, just entrepreneurship at large, like 5 years ago, like, naive me would think if I could build a company, sell it for 50, 100 mil, like, that's awesome. I don't give a shit about anything else. Like, I'm good. But like, as you go on the journey, you realize how many early adopters like trusted you with your product before they should have. Like, we were like as bad of a product as we'd ever be. Yeah. And they're like, I'm going to leave like my very established thing. And like, this is a business for me. I'm making 10K a month off this newsletter, but I'm going to trust you. We're up at night emailing back and forth. I'm debugging things for them. Like, you realize how many people trust you and go out of their way on this like entrepreneurship startup journey. And like, I can never fuck them over. Like, I like genuinely have such sympathy and appreciation for the people who trusted me early on, knowing that I care about this business a lot. I care about them succeeding. And so when you consider different acquisition opportunities, like, it's no longer like, what's the best for me financially? It's what's an actual good home in the future that I know our users are taking care of. And like, Beehiiv as a product and ecosystem will grow and be sustainable. And that's something like, it takes like maturity to really think about that and go through like the ups and downs of building a company.
Yeah.
To like 20-year-old me, would be like, wait, I can make 10, 15 million. And like, who gives a shit who helped me like get there?
Yeah.
But like, that changes so much when you're actually in the weeds. And
Your team.
Yeah, for sure.
Team, are they going to be okay? Are their jobs safe? Like, there's a lot that comes into an acquisition that I think a lot of people don't understand.
I just thought the optionality thing was so interesting to think about. Cause like, when you raise very little money, like a $12 million valuation seed, anyone who approaches you for like 40, 50 mil, like, every investor is happy, employees are happy, co-founders are happy. Like, that's a successful exit. And the second you take that next round of venture capital, like, the bar is just so much higher.
Yeah.
And I think people get caught up with like the headline of how much money you raise and what the new valuation is. Like, the valuation doesn't mean anything unless you're taking secondary, which most founders don't. And like, especially like in a Series A, that valuation did nothing but make your life considerably harder and set the bar so much higher for what you now have to accomplish. And until Austin like really drilled that in my, until I had the term sheet in front of me and then an acquisition around the offer around the same time being like, here's an exit ramp and here's me signing up for like 5 more years of this, hoping that it's going to be 10x what this acquisition is. And it is like a very weird circumstance that I never really thought about until I was in that moment.
I'm really glad that you're sharing it so candidly, because I do think I really want to normalize no more celebrating rounds.
That's part of the reason I hated VC too. The fact that you were able to convince some VC who's not even an expert in your space that you're worth X amount of dollars doesn't mean anything. And it becomes less meaningful when you see people raising like at a $40 million valuation, pre-product, pre-users, pre-everything. It's like valuations, I think, are bullshit.
Yeah, totally bullshit.
And celebrating them are even dumber, I think. So
I remember we raised similar 2.8 in early 2022, so about a year and a half ago. I remember everyone was like, why didn't you raise 5 on 25? We raised 2.8 on 12.5. And
that's what we did.
I remember, we took almost the exact same deal. We haven't raised since. But the thing was like, what do you mean? Raise more, higher valuation. And then like immediately after it was like, oh, you could do a follow-on round. Look, like you guys have some traction. There's a creator co-founder. And now all those businesses that took that extra money or raised at some absurd valuation, they either have to down round or they're never going to raise more money. And so it really kind of rang true on like, oh yeah, all of this stuff is just the headline.
It's all on paper money that doesn't mean anything. And so when early investors, which we're fortunate to have great early investors,
yeah,
but some would be like, when are you going to raise that next round? It's like, I'm not building this to raise your on paper valuation of what your portfolio is worth.
Yeah.
I'm focusing on revenue, profits, and scaling a business, and the rest will come, or it'll lead to a better exit opportunity for you. But the on paper, one investor evaluates this company at whatever, I think is what a lot of, and maybe it's just like the economy of like what the press covers and what gets celebrated. But for me, like, it's cool that I feel more security that we're not going to go out of business in 3 months.
Yep.
And that we actually demand more respect and can innovate and be on a stronger foundation to accelerate and be a dominant player in this space. Outside of that, like we just said, like, I feel more pressure. And I just said, like, we're going to do this for the next 5+ years and really ramp this up, and totally different mindset.
Well, I tip my hat to you, sir, for signing up for that game. I think it's an incredibly, in the true nature of risky business, is the riskiest option you could have chose, but the one that I think is a noble one, one that locks you into the arena for many years to come. But I think I believe in you, and I believe in the product, and the value that you guys are offering seems to be quite undeniable. And I think it's also, there are a lot of founders that they get into this game and it becomes, what metrics do I need to show? What KPIs get the next round of investors excited? And then how do I get to a place where some secondaries can like, I can take some secondaries off the table so that I'm a little bit more comfortable. And I think that's just such a bad way of playing the game. I think there is a true superpower for real entrepreneurs to get into the venture game where they don't act like the rest of the like venture-backed entrepreneurs, and they go, how do I focus on like people, product, and profits, like in that order, and not give a shit about all this other facade in this entrepreneurial game? And there's so many people that I think do a move, get a really sexy headline, and then they feel really good about themselves. The like validation floods in from Twitter, and then they're like, all right.
You know, I've also discovered in this too, how many companies raised a shit ton of money, like 15, 20 mil, lost all traction and are just sitting on a bank account of 15. I think that'd be like a really interesting like series, or like, I don't know. I've met a few people that like were in the peak hype of 2020, 2021, raised a ton of money. The money's in the bank account, but like the business isn't going super well. They've laid off a ton of people, still have plenty of money. Like, what? It's just like, are they pivoting? Are they exploring new things? Are they just paying themselves and chilling? Like, there's like a whole like economy.
It's like quiet quitting of founders.
Like, I don't know. I'm so interested in that, because like, what happens when you raise a $15 million round? The product is not taking off at all. You fired most people. You're just paying yourself well and kind of chilling. Like, I don't know.
It is interesting. I imagine like a lot of founders, yeah, you either go like, okay, are we going to admit that this isn't going the way we want? And then do we give the money back? Which I think is quite a noble thing to do for an entrepreneur, because it's quite an ego hit, but quite like, okay, what's next? And let me just admit it rather than keep paying myself a salary and trying, or saying like, hey, we're going to take a hard pivot. We have a new idea. We're going to run it by the investors. Do you still want to be in? If you don't, we'll give you your money back. I haven't seen too many people do that, at least publicly. But I do think that that's the type of thing where you really build a reputation for yourself as an entrepreneur. I've always said like, what we're building with Creator Now, it's probably nothing, but if it hits, it's going to be big.
Yeah.
And so like, what I'm building is a fucking moonshot. And I took it very consciously, knowing that, like, I want to raise some money because I want to take the moonshot in my career. I'm also 30, similar age as you. And, like, if it works, it's going to be massive. But the likelihood that all these things, like, I throw the fucking dart through three Cheerios and it hits, is low. And I tell everybody on the team that joins, like, this is going to be really hard. And the probability of success is really low.
Hell of a sales pitch.
But if it hits,
yeah,
fuck, it's going to hit big, I think. So if you want to be on board and solve a really hard problem, build an industry-defining platform, well, you're in the right place. But if you're looking for like a cushy thing where you show up at 9 and leave at 5 and like everything's super secure and safe around you and every day is like predictable, yeah, definitely not the place for you.
Yeah.
And I think that that's a...
I think expectation setting is like something I've actually learned as I've hired more and more that I need to do better, not on that front, but like we are in the content creation space and like people create controversial content on our platform. And something that's come up before from employees is like, hey, I don't really align with... And like content moderation is so hard. No platform has nailed it. Like the best in the world with the best lawyers, best, most thoughtful people on their team have not nailed content, like just how to deal with different controversial topics on a platform, who's liable, how do you treat it, how do you respect your employees? But how do you know that your employee is like kind of signed up knowing that they're not going to agree with everything? And you're never going to have a platform that has everything being created on it agreeable. So this is like an interesting, like one thing I would share with other entrepreneurs, whether it's this is going to be a grind and difficult and like if it hits, it hits, but like it's not your cushy 9 to 5, or just like another random example of like you might not agree with everything that is posted on this platform, but that's not your job. Like our job is to create, like if you are in support or you're an engineer or whatever it is, like that is your job. And I'm curious to hear your thoughts and like I'm open to learning from other perspectives. But setting the expectation that like there's other parts of the job, I think is something that I could have done better in general. Mm-hmm. And that's just like one example. But anytime you onboard a new employee, I think it's always better during the hiring process to let people know what they're signing up for every aspect of the business. Prior to their already on payroll, they have expectations that you've given them like a very important task to own. And then they raise flags that you probably could have flagged a little bit earlier. So
yeah. It's so true. Yeah, I think every platform goes through that as well. Well, sir, I feel like we could chat about a bunch of things all day. As wrap up thoughts, outside of the news on this exciting raise
No congratulations
on will be given. Any interesting product teasers or things that are in the pipeline that I'll give you congratulations for? Anything there that we should be excited about?
Yeah, very broadly, I'll say like two letters, AI. So we are very carefully and thoughtfully exploring some AI integrations that would help content creation, whether it's text, stories, images, reaching audiences easier, where the power of one person can be the power of many. And like that is really the balance with like a content creation platform. To replace the writer, the journalist, the person who's coming up with the ideas and curating the stories, to get a very delicate balance. Because like we aren't trying to replace our users, obviously. Mm-hmm. We're trying to augment what they can do with their already ability to write stories, curate stories. How can we summarize better? How can we give them a better image? How can we have them reach new audiences easier without them doing the work? And so we've had like a very careful and methodical approach to rolling out AI, and I don't know when this is airing, but it'll either be live or being live soon. So we'll see.
Let's leave it at that. All right, Tyler, it's been a gift and a pleasure having you here. I look forward to seeing what Beehiiv does, and I'm sure it will take over the email space for years to come.
Cool. Appreciate it, man.
Cheers, bro.
Cheers. La croix.
La croix.